the Spotlight with Adam Sanchez.
Hello, I'm your host, Adam Sanchez, and this is In the Spotlight. My guest today is Jenny Brechtel. She is a professor here at Benedictine University. She is a current graduate from Benedictine University, and she is also the marketing coordinator at Intact LLC. How are you doing today?
Good, how are you?
I'm good. How would you describe your time as a student at Benedictine?
I would say busy. Busy actually is an understatement. I definitely kept myself busy in sports. I was on the tennis team. I wrote for the Candor. I was the editor of Eye the Eagle, and I did some webcasting for some of the men's and women's basketball games, all while taking classes and having a part-time job as well.
Okay, great. As a senior, I know you completed your internship with the Kane County Cougars. Can you explain a little about their organization?
Sure. The Kane County Cougars are a minor league baseball team. Basically, they are affiliated with a major league baseball team. They will sign a bunch of rookies, and their rookies will play for them. It's their low A team. So they'll have a contract and they'll play for us, and then they would move up in the ranks to try and play for Major League Baseball. The Cougars are, you know, family fun. Basically, they try and get families to come to the games and enjoy a day at the ballpark without the price and, you know, the travel that you would have to go to for a White Sox game or a Cubs game.
Mm-hmm. What were some of your duties as an intern with the Cougars?
Well, when I started with the Cougars, I was a ticket intern. Now, I never understood. They used to always say, when you're working for a minor league sports team, you wear a lot of hats, and I never got what that meant. But I was with them for five seasons, and I have done probably anything that you could think of at the ballpark, whether it be pulling the tarp. I worked in the ticket office. I helped with the on-field camera during the games, anything like that. So it depended on the day. It depended on the game, anything like that. It was just tasks on tasks on tasks, I guess you can say.
Yeah. What were some of your favorite and least favorite duties?
Least favorite duty, I would probably say, would be pulling the tarp, especially when you would have to pull it in the pouring rain on game day, and there would be sometimes you'd have to pull it multiple times. Mm-hmm. You know, you pull the tarp onto the field during the middle of the day before the game, then you pull it off the field for, you know, before the game starts, and then maybe it's the third inning and it starts raining again. You got to pull the tarp back onto the field in the pouring rain in front of everybody. That was definitely not an exciting task. I loved doing the video camera on the field. I loved doing any of the video camera stuff when I was here at Benedictine, so I was glad that I was able to pull that into a different experience and be able to use it in the sports world with baseball.
Other than your internship at the Cougars, what else did you do to prepare yourself for the future?
I had the internship here with Mr. Seeley doing the Eye the Eagle. I was writing articles for the Candor, and I was I had a part-time job as well as a secretary, trying to do all of these different things just to get as many experiences as I could in the small amount of time that I was here.
Okay, before you said that they had minor league players playing for the Cougars, did you meet any players that eventually went on to become or to make it to the MLB?
Yeah, actually, Chesler Cuthbert plays for the Kansas City Royals right now. And actually, Kyle Schwarber, who had one awesome year, he was at the Cougars my last season, and he was one of the nicest guys. So it's really cool to be able to see them become, professional.
Okay, that's all the time we have for right now. When we come back, we will talk about how the internship helped her for her future and why internships are important.
Welcome to Ben News for the month of October. I'm Adriana Salcedo.
And I'm Molly Morley, and here are the top stories. It's that time of year again. Family Weekend was a success once again. Many families of students and faculty filled the campus for festivities. Families can enjoy a range of activities Friday with an anticipation of the big football game on Saturday. Sunday morning was the annual Sydney Sobranski 5K run. Eye of the Eagles, Kara Epting, talked with Rob Sobranski about his dedication to this event and the work that he does with the Victim Impact Panel.
Hi, I'm Kara Epping, and I'm here today with Rob Sobranski. We are talking about Family Weekend, and right now is a great ending with the 5K. So how do you think that event went?
The event is excellent again this year. The turnout is very good, a beautiful day out here. This is our 12th walk. It's in honor of my daughter Cindy, who we lost, unfortunately, at the hands of a drunk driver back in 2004. She was a student here at Benedictine in the pre-med program, studying to be a surgical nurse or pharmacist. And after we lost her, the club she was in, I think at that time it was called Best Buddies, I don't know if it's still on campus, they're the ones who started the walk, and now it's continued with the great help of the university.
I know you guys do a lot of work with the Victim Impact Panel. What kind of things do you do with them?
Well, that work actually is with an organization I'm part of called AIM, Alliance Against Intoxicated Motorists. And what it is, anyone in the state of Illinois, the counties up here, whoever gets a DUI ticket, the judges will make them come to what exactly it is called a Victim Impact Panel. And we hold those actually twice a month here on it. Actually, we have space for that victim. But what it is, they come and they hear a one-hour talk by maybe three or four presenters, what the impact of drunk driving into a family. Specifically, I talk about how it affected our family when we lost Cindy.
What kind of effect do you have, like, that you hope you leave one last year?
Well, what we hope, and the reality is we probably have about 200 people on those Monday nights, and you don't reach all of them, but a lot of them you do, and you tell them the story that, hey, you know what? You're going to go out and party, it's fine, but go out with a plan. Go out with $50, $100 in your wallet, call a cab, do anything you want. Don't be get behind the wheel, because I actually tell the people sitting in the audience, they're very lucky sitting there. They just got a DUI. What happened if they didn't get stopped and they traveled another 2-3 blocks, another 2-3 miles? Who knows, they could have hit somebody, and they could have killed themselves, a passenger. That's what we hope to get that across, that, hey, it's not worth it. Yes, party, there's no problem with that. Just don't drive. It's not worth it, especially nowadays. And a lot cheaper to put $100 in your wallet than to go through a DUI, let me tell you that.
Well, thank you so much for being here today.
The Syrian Revolution is a serious tragedy happening in the Middle East today. With over 4 million refugees since 2011, a crisis is among us. Dr. Miriam Cook from Duke University studies Middle Eastern history and spoke at Benedictine about the tragedy going on. She spoke in Goodwin Hall on Thursday, September 29th. Eye of the Eagles, Vanessa Salazar, talked with Dr. Cook about this revolution.
Hey, this is Vanessa Salazar with Eye of the Eagle, here with Dr. Miriam Cook to discuss her new book that came out at the Global Studies Forum tonight. Hello, thank you for joining us. You had mentioned that you had released a book about the revolution. Can you give us a little insight that, or some hope that you hope to gain from your audience when you give your speech?
Yes, and thank you for inviting me to talk with you. Yes, my book, Dancing in Damascus, Creativity, Resilience, and the Syrian Revolution, I think is probably going to be counterintuitive for many people. So how can we now think about what's going on in Syria as something we can talk about in celebration? Because we always think of dancing as celebration. But I picked this title because I really feel that the outpouring of art, videos, films, novels, cartoons, it's been absolutely extraordinary, in fact, unprecedented, gives a sense of the hope that the revolutionaries have that they can actually ultimately succeed. Years from now, we will be able to look back and say, okay, well, this is where things were in 2016. So this is my tiny little contribution to the persistence of the revolution.
So do you think maybe you can almost compare the revolution that's going on in Syria as to, like, what's going on in the United States? Really all the violence and, like, the murders and, like, the dictators and everything that's going on recently, do you think that can almost compare to that?
I think it's a little different because what we have here is a real presidency. So the people have a chance every 4 years to elect the ruler they want. What has been so different in these Arab Spring countries is that the rulers that they've had have been dictators. They, not in all cases, but in some cases, took over from the previous dictator in a military coup. The regime is raining down barrel bombs onto people who have nothing.
Right.
And it's what Paul Virilio called a pure war. And a pure war is where the state attacks its own people. Mm-hmm. So this is what I see happening there. What's happening in America, of course, is so different because guns are so available. The news about every killing is now circulated so fast through social media that for those who are unhappy with their lot in life, they're inspired.
And for those that don't really know exactly what's going on, what exactly is going on in Syria, the revolution there?
Well, because there is international press is not allowed in there, we see it through citizen journalists' footage. We're seeing it in a very strange way. What we know is that over the past 5 years, over 450,000 people have been killed. What we know is that a country that in 2011 had a population of 23 million now has half of that population out of their homes. 9 million internally displaced, 5 million, 4 to 5 million who are refugees. We have no idea how many are in jail. So what we know is that a man with a ruthless father who modeled the way that you keep control on your people does not care that he is practicing what feels like ethnic cleansing of his own people.
Thank you so much for speaking with us. Happy to hear your forum a little later tonight. It's Vanessa Salazar from the Eye of the Eagle. Thank you very much.
The Benedictine UNICEF Club held their general body meeting on Thursday, September 22nd. UNICEF has already accomplished much in their efforts to help those affected by the Zika virus. In various ways, they are going to help depressed areas with vaccines and diagnostic tests. The Vice President of UNICEF, Michelle Pazisky, was interviewed regarding the club's efforts towards protecting mothers and children in depressed areas dealing with the Zika virus, as well as the upcoming water walk.
Hi, I'm Adriana Salcedo with Eye of the Eagle. I'm here with Vice President of the UNICEF Club, Michelle Pazisky. Today, she hosted the event of the general body meeting regarding Zika virus and water walk coming up. Today you started off the meeting with a little game similar to Hot Potato that had to do with the Zika virus. Can you kind of tell us how it related to the Zika virus?
Okay, so we played, it was like Hot Potato, but with like a different toy. And what it was supposed to represent was how Zika virus spreads and how fast it spreads. And it's very random and it's just like a fast occurring event. So that's what we wanted to represent, something to be like more fun and enjoyable, like for the beginning of the meeting so people weren't like bored or anything like that. That's why we did it.
So everyone was kind of throwing around this squid, like the Hot Potato. Mm-hmm. And everyone that got this Hot Potato was randomly selected, like the Zika virus. Mm-hmm. So everyone that got that, they were receiving a red check that signified the Zika virus?
Yes, they were receiving like a red note card that showed them that they were infected by Zika.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So
What kind of steps is UNICEF taking towards promoting and helping out the people that were affected by the Zika virus?
So what they're doing is that they're spreading awareness to like 200 million people, I believe, in like South America and the Caribbean, and they're just telling them how they can like prevent being bitten by a mosquito. And they also have two diagnostic tests available for people to know if they do have Zika. And they're working on two candidate vaccines. So they don't have those vaccines yet because there isn't a vaccine for Zika virus, but they're working on it. So they're just like trying to spread awareness and help any way they can, especially like mothers and children in like underdeveloped countries and stuff like that.
Well, that's awesome. So what kind of help has already UNICEF provided?
Well, what we usually do is we help mothers and children, because like 1.5 billion children die under the age of 5 every single year, and that's like 800 million children per day. So what we try to do is we try just to provide them with safe drinking water, and we want to provide them hygiene, and we want to make sure that they get the vaccines they need. So that's what UNICEF does. They bring vaccines, clean water. They make sure that, like, if there's, like, a crisis going on around the world, like a natural disaster, we're, like, the first ones at the country and stuff like that, providing our help until it's, like, the country is, like, sustained and stuff like that. So we just do anything we can to help children and, like, mothers, especially, like, pregnant mothers, because we want them to be able to get like the nutrients they like need, and just so like the child is able to have like a childhood. Yeah. Like many kids like in America are like able to have like a childhood, and we want all kids around the world to be able to have all the needs, the basic needs satisfied.
Okay, so what kind of efforts can other Benedictine students take to support this and to help out?
Well, we have many events that go on during the year, like trick or treat for UNICEF, water walk. We had the hunger banquet, not last year, but the previous year before that. So we just like host a lot of events, so they could participate in those events. They can come to our GBMs where we spread awareness of all the different different problems that face our world today, and. Yeah, just like come to our GBNs, come out to our events, and just like that's how just volunteering and spreading awareness of what's going on is going to help.
When are the GBMs?
So we have the GBMs every second and fourth Thursday of the month. So yeah, second and fourth Thursday.
Okay. And the water walk is coming up October 1st. What can we expect to see from the water walker? The turnout.
Well, we're hoping the turnout will be really good. We want a lot of teams to participate, so you just have to register. You can register online. Like, we have flyers everywhere, so there's, like, a QR code that you can look at. But we also have, we're tabling, so you can register at the table, like, during, like, the second, like, this week and next week, we're going to be tabling. So just anytime before the event, if you need to, you could email us, you know. So just anytime, just register. And it should be fun. There should be a lot of people, like water, just a lot of excitement, I guess. Yeah. It's going to be cool.
Okay. Well, what kind of days, what are the dates to sign up for this water walk for all students?
This week and next week. So it just any day, because you can sign up online.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Michelle. It was nice meeting you and getting to go to this meeting and learning a little bit about the event. I hope it's a great turnout. It seems like a lot of people are going.
Yeah, hopefully.
Okay. I'm Adriana from Eye of the Eagle, and this is Michelle from UNICEF. Thank you.
On October 1st, the UNICEF Club held their annual water walk in the basement of CRAZA. There was a total of 9 teams that signed up to play a number of fun water relay games. Everyone that participated paid $30, and 100% of the proceeds went to the Tap Water Project that allows children to receive clean water. There was music, laughter, and lots of fun. Erica Robinson talked to student and president of the club, Hafsa Sarah Juden, about the turnout of the event.
Hi, this is Erica Robinson here for Eye of the Eagle, and I'm here with Hafsa Sarah Juden. It's very nice to see you. I just want to talk to you a little bit about the water walk. Can you tell me what charity is the proceeds for the water walk going to?
Yeah, so UNICEF is going to donate 100% of the proceeds to the Tap Water Project, which basically helps install water pumps in developing countries. So a lot of kids in developing countries, they don't have access to fresh fresh clean water. And right now, studies show they have to walk for about 5 hours just to get a clean drink of water. And so that's why we do it. We want to donate this to that charity so that they can get this water.
Are you excited about how the event?
We are so excited just because we were supposed to have it outside and it just started raining on us and we had to come up with something to do like a backup plan very fast, and so it was very exciting because our group got together, we decided to pass up and find the underground to the race space, and we just did three races and I think everyone really enjoyed it. So
awesome. So when did the water walk actually get started for UNICEF?
So UNICEF, UNICEF started after World War II to help the kids. Okay. The Tap Water Project, it did start in the middle after World War II. And so it was just the whole initiative was just to bring more water to the developing countries. And after 1946, it was started then. So, yeah.
And why is the water walk so significant to UNICEF?
UNICEF signifies helping kids die from zero preventable diseases. And so when kids are faced with having to drink dirty water on a daily basis, they're getting diseases like cholera and diarrhea and all of those things that they don't need to have, and they're preventable. And so that's why we do the water walk, because they get to have a better life, and what's better than that, right, helping kids.
Well, I thank you so much for just having this time with me and sharing a little bit about the water walk. This is Erica again. Thank you.
On October 2nd, Byzantine icon painter Arlene Tillman gave a lecture at the Benedictine Art Gallery that focused on the history and the meaning of iconography. Tillman discussed the styles and techniques used by the icon painter, as well as her own work in the field. She gave an in-depth look at the symbolism in Catholic icon paintings. Ramir Shihu spoke with Tillman at the event.
Okay, I'm here with Arlene Tillman. She just gave a lecture on Byzantine art and iconography. I just wanted to ask you about, you talked about symbolism in your lecture, and you talked about how whenever you're commissioned to do work, there's not much room for creativity. Is there, does creativity come into the symbolism part of it?
No. Creativity can only come into maybe the artist's style. The creativity comes into maybe the colors that they're using, but the symbolism has to be put down and put down on the icons as what was handed to us from tradition, from the older, more ancient iconographers of the Ancient of Days. So our creativity is going to come in the use of the colors and maybe in the faces too, because the faces, it's like a handwriting. We finally get our style of our own, and so the creativity is going to come out in that more than anything.
Okay. And you've been commissioned to do work by churches, monasteries. How many in total do you think you've worked for over the years?
Oh my. I know I've done probably 3-4 iconostas churches, and then there's single icons in Texas, California, Canada. I've done several. I mean, I
all over the U.S.
Yes,
probably. And Europe as well.
A couple in Europe and a couple in Canada as well. Yes.
Okay, and of all your works, what would you say your favorite pieces are?
My favorite pieces. Probably that Holy Trinity icon that I did, and I keep that one for myself.
What do you like about it?
I guess the three angels in it and the colors, and it just seemed to come alive on its own, so it has a sense of peace about it, which kind of gives me whenever I look at it.
So. Thank you for the interview.
Okay, thank you very much for having me.
On September 29, Benedictine University hosted an event in Kinlan Hall on the fifth floor at the Art Gallery. Peter Seeley, Communication Department Chairman, spoke about his book, Stoogeology. Students, faculty and staff, and Benedictine community came out to hear background information in several chapters. Some of the clips that were shown were from the Three Stooges short films. Eye of the Eagle's Autumn Grady talked with Professor Seeley on his main focus and the importance of the book, and how he was chosen to be the faculty author.
I'm Autumn Grady from Benedictine Eye of the Eagle, and tonight I'm here with Professor Seeley from the Communication Department. He did get me the a powerful association. I have a few questions for you. What was the following your association?
Well, the focus of it was to do a scholarly work on the Three Stooges, which had never been done before. You have fan books and things like that, but never a serious study. And I've done serious studies of them, as have a lot of other faculty from academics from around the country. So there were so many different angles that we wrote from. So we just did a general book, studies of sociology, politics, war, race, ethnicity, just so many different things that the book focused on.
How did you choose to be the faculty author?
Well, it was my idea. So I pitched the idea to a publishing company, and the first one I pitched it to, they actually liked it. And so I got these various people from around the country to contribute. And so I wrote 10 chapters, the rest of them together wrote 9 chapters. And then I got Gail Piper, who used to teach at Benedictine, to be my co-editor. So it was my project from the beginning. I just couldn't understand why nobody else had ever done it before, so.
And my last question, what is the importance of your book?
Well, like I said, there really hadn't been a serious or scholarly study of the Stooges until Stoogeology, but also there's humor in general isn't taken very, it's kind of funny to say, isn't taken very seriously, mm-hmm. but it isn't studied very seriously, except in very particular cases like Charlie Chaplin or Buster Keaton. But I think there's a lot of good material for scholarship for comedy that people just don't pay enough attention to it from a scholarly point of view.
And thank you personally. This is
The stresses of the fall semester might weigh heavily on most students at Benedictine University, but not all students are feeling overwhelmed. Benedictine Sand Club, sponsored by the Nutrition Department, has come up with a unique way to combat the pressures of everyday school life through aromatherapy yoga. We all go to the field to hear from the club's president, Tatiana Arturo, about the benefits yoga can have on the student body here at Benedictine.
Hello, my name is Marla Loudon. I'm here with Eye of the Eagle, Benedictine's broadcasting network, and I'm here with Tatiana in the Dan Rice Center. And Tatiana has just given a aromatherapy yoga session. Now, Tatiana, you are part of a club called SAN. What does that stand for?
That's the Student Association of Nutrition and Dietetics.
That's awesome. And one of your guys' goals is to obviously promote health among the student body. How does an event like aromatherapy yoga, how does that help people at this university?
Well, I personally think it's really important for students to take time for themselves. You know, mm-hmm. It gets really busy with all the school projects and everything, and so you can often get stuck in a routine, so it's good for us to kind of engage in physical activity, but also that's a really stressful thing, so.
It definitely is. But is this something you do for yourself? Is this something that you've been doing for a while? Could you just tell us more about your own experience with this?
Sure, absolutely. I would say I started doing yoga ever since like I was in junior high. Mm-hmm. So it's been a while, and personally it's helped me just kind of focus on my well-being, like emotionally, spiritually, mentally, and that in itself can help me be like a better student in general, but it's just my perfect way to relieve stress. And I've also been teaching since high school, so I just really like to engage students in stress relieving activities, just because I think it's really important. It's something that can easily be overlooked. We don't really focus on mental health as much, and that's why I definitely want to bring it into Nutrition Club, because that's really essential for being healthy.
Yeah, no, I definitely believe so. You definitely don't hear much about it. You always think about sports when you think of university health and stuff like that. You don't necessarily think about the mental health of the students, and I think it's really good that we have someone here promoting that. Now, this session was about 30 minutes. do you think that 30 minutes a day or 30 minutes every other day, do you think that can make a large impact in a regular student's life here at college?
You know, I would even say as little as 5 minutes a day can make a big difference. Because like I said, we can get stuck in a routine of go, 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 you know, I got to do this and that, and a bunch of different school and work responsibilities, where even just 5 minutes a day where you're taking to slow down, kind of clear your head and say, I can do this, I'm okay, let's move forward. That's all you need, really. So.
That's very good. So you are a part of SAND, and is there any more upcoming events? What are you guys doing around campus?
Well, next week we are doing a vegetarian cooking lab. It's going to be Vegetarian Awareness Month, so we'll be in the kitchen kind of preparing different vegetarian meals. Mm-hmm. And then we will be doing in the future a smoothie sale on campus, so we want to get different smoothie recipes out for students to try and kind of a rethink your drink kind of thing.
That's really awesome. It's all the stuff that we don't necessarily hear about, but it's so great that you're doing all this stuff, like, for the health of the student body, just really getting it all out there. Thank you so much for all your time. This is Marla Loudon. This concludes our segment out here in the field, and we'll see you later.
On Wednesday, September 28, Benedictine had its first concert of the year, which featured the Jazz Ensemble Band. The evening highlighted some of the great contributions to the music genre. Some of the songs presented in the concert included a rendition of Henry Mancini's The Pink Panther and Rodgers and Hart's Falling in Love with Love. Eye of the Eagle's Genevieve Murray spoke with Patrick Infusino about the evening's performance.
I'm Genevieve Murray for Eye of the Eagle, here with Patrick Infusino. We just had the Jazz Ensemble concert, and in the concert you said that the theme of the evening was emotions. Could you explain for us what that means for the composers and for the players?
Okay, well first, the composers are trying to get across a certain type of emotion, either happy or sorrowful or melancholy, and we have to kind of interpret that through our playing. And the selections we used tonight, all of them basically were in that kind of mode of it's showing emotions. And our musicians are, they're geared up to play improvisation. And I always tell them, use a little emotion, use a little flair, so you get it across to the audience.
Alrighty, and how long in advance do you need to start prepping for a concert like this?
Usually about maybe 6 weeks. This was the first concert of the season, and we only had since the beginning of school, so which really was about 5 weeks, and so we were pushing pretty hard.
Sounds intense. So in the program for the evening, there are 14 students listed. Is that a typical number?
It varies from semester to semester. Last semester we had about 16, a couple years ago we had 20, it all depends. It's nice that the instrumentation is equal in terms of saxes and trumpets, you know, and rhythm section, but when I first started out in 2010, we had 4 students, and I also had to play along more, and then, you know, semester after semester, year after year, it just kind of grew.
All right, well, nice that it's growing. Do you have a favorite piece of the ones that were played this evening?
Yeah, tonight I liked the Oliver Nelson, You Love But Once. He's one of my favorite composers and musicians because there's a lot of emotion in his pieces, and this piece especially, it showed that there were some classical themes, the blues, and a lot of modern harmonies, and I think... you know, this arrangement was typical of his style.
All right, well, thanks for a great concert. This is Genevieve Murray for Eye of the Eagle. Thank you.
Swine flu, Ebola, and now the most recent, the Zika virus, is terrifying people around the globe. An event sponsored by the Public Health took place on September 20th in Goodwin Hall. 3 experts from the U.S. Army that specialize in infectious disease spoke about the current outbreak. The discussion included where the disease came from, symptoms, and preventative measures. According to the Center of Disease Control, nearly 3,500 cases have been reported in the United States. and those cases, 67 in Illinois. Eye of the Eagle's Caitlin Wolfgram was there to speak with one of the experts about the horrific disease.
Can you explain what the Zika virus is?
Sure. So Zika is an RNA virus. It's part of the flavivirus family. It's very similar to other viruses like dengue and yellow fever, so other diseases that you may have heard of. And I think that it's a virus that tends to cause just a mild flu-like illness in those folks who are actually symptomatic, because we know that a good portion of people can be exposed to the virus but actually be asymptomatic. But I think the importance from a public health standpoint is the impact on an unborn fetus. And I think that's why it's really come to the forefront and why we're here today to talk about it, why there's interest about it. Because we've found that in women who contract Zika and are pregnant at the time, that there can be potential neurologic outcomes like microcephaly, impact on the infant's vision, hearing, etc. So there are other potential impacts on adults. We talked about Guillain-Barré today, which essentially is an acute immune-mediated peripheral neuropathy that can cause a paralysis even in an adult. And things like myelitis and meningoencephalitis. So all of these central nervous system problem issues, but really the impact that it's had on the unborn fetus and then the children after birth and on. So that's what brought us here today, and a little bit about Zika and why it's so fascinating, and that we're learning things literally month to month about this virus.
Now, I know you said that a lot of people have seen it in Florida. So for people in Illinois, what do you think our risk is?
So we talked a little bit about the sweep through the Americas and the vector, which the main vector is the Aedes aegypti mosquito. And in the United States, this mosquito tends to live more in the southern states, more around the Gulf. Okay, and as humans can serve as a mobile reservoir with having the virus in our bloodstream for a set period of time, if one of these mosquitoes feeds on somebody that has this virus circulating, you know, then that mosquito can then potentially transmit to another human. By the vast majority of the cases we've seen in the United States, the people acquired the Zika somewhere outside the country. So we call that travel associated. That's a vast majority of the cases we have seen here in the U.S. Florida is a unique situation because it combines several factors. It has that vector there in a pretty high population. You have high density cities like Miami, and we know this mosquito likes to hang out in urban environments. On top of that, you have a lot of travelers between Florida and Central and South America. So again, that mobile vector. And it's just kind of why Florida has so far been the one place where there's local transmission. So Illinois, it's not really where we suspect the vector thrives. Okay, so I don't suspect that particular state will have a problem with local transmission. But of course it's a problem if pregnant women, you know, through the U.S. travel to areas where there's ongoing transmission and potentially acquire Zika. That's still obviously a problem.
And I know people are a little bit nervous, and I know you talked about some things that you can do, just wearing like long sleeve shirts and bug spray.
Is that right? Yes. So we had two other speakers here with us today, Colonel Blow and Major Calvano. Major Calvano is another infectious disease physician like myself, but Colonel Blow She works in preventive medicine, and then she's also an entomologist, and she went over some of the personal protective measures that you can utilize when potentially traveling to these areas, using usually a 25% to 30% DEET product on your, you know, skin. And nowadays you can find this in all different type of preparations. Also wearing preferably long sleeve, long pants if you're going to be spending a lot of outdoor time. And then you can even treat your clothing with permethrin, which embeds into the clothing. And it will stay embedded into the clothing for several months as long as you do not dry clean it. You can regular launder it. Dry cleaning will inactivate it, but so these are potential safety measures. You know, you can do use bed netting if you're staying in overseas somewhere that doesn't have air conditioning or the ability to have windows. You can use bed netting, etc. So just some of the things you could do while traveling to protect yourself.
Okay. And then, if somebody wants to know more information about the Zika virus, where do you think they should go?
So a great site that has a lot of resources is this CDC website, which is just cdc.gov, G-O-V. And literally on their homepage, there's a link to all the Zika information, a lot of it that we discussed today. So if people want to just go to their website and kind of read up on the wealth of information that they have there. That's a great place to start.
Great. Well, thank you so much for being here today, and thank you for the interview, and your talk was really fascinating.
Oh, well, thank you for having us. It's been a pleasure.
On October 1st, Benedictine University had their third home football game. Always there to support them is the Benedictine University cheerleading team. The team consists of 11 girls. They cheer at all the home games no matter what the weather is like outside. Eye of the Eagle reporter Adaria Washington spoke to the Benedictine student and senior Jasmine Aaron about what it means for her to be a cheerleader and her 4 years being a cheerleader at Benedictine University.
Hi, I'm Adaria Washington here with Eye of the Eagle, and I'm here with senior and 4 year veteran Jasmine Aaron, who's on the cheerleading team. So Jasmine, do you think cheerleaders should be considered athletes?
Yes, I think cheerleaders should be considered athletes. They get to wear a combination of dance and gymnastics, do a lot of powerlifting, a lot of power maneuvers, so it can be a little dangerous, so I think it's good.
What is the most important thing that makes a cheerleading team successful?
I think it's people going out and doing work outside of practice, like going to the gym, making sure they're eating healthy, stretching, all that kind of stuff that pertains to what we do on the team.
Okay, and lastly, what are your goals for the team this year?
We're actually looking to go to state this year for our winning championship. We haven't been in competition for a while, but we're hoping that with a good team, we're going to be out there and winning the title this year.
That's been news for October. I'm Adriana Saucedo.
And I'm Molly Morley, and here is Erica Robinson with sports. Erica, it seems like the football team is starting out really well this year.
Yes, they are. They're 2-1, and they're doing really great. But we'll have more about the sports later on in the show.
Hi, this is Benedictine Sports with Erica Robinson. Benedictine women's volleyball team hosted a tournament in the Dan and Ada Rice Center on September 23rd and 24th. Although the team worked and trained their hardest, they did not walk away victorious. They left with scores of 2-3 against University of Dubuque, 1-3 against Central College, 1-3 against Simpson College, and 0-3 against Luther College. When practice came around the next week, they pushed themselves even harder to prepare themselves for their next competition. Alyssa O'Boyle spoke with Eye of the Eagle reporter Jazzy Jones about their practice schedule and the team she looks most forward to playing.
Hi, this is Jazzy with Eye of the Eagle at Benedictine. I'm here with Alyssa on the volleyball team.
Hi, Alyssa.
Hi. So I just have a couple questions for you. How did you get involved with volleyball?
Well, I've been playing volleyball since I was 8, so, and all my sisters were playing, so it's just kind of like, I watched them since I was little, and then I decided, well, I want to play, and
now I'm That's so cute. Yeah. And which opponent are you looking
I'm definitely looking forward to playing against her university because my sister is actually one of the assistant coaches there. So it's going to be kind of like neat to like go against her and stuff. They're always one of our biggest opponents. Yeah.
And how often do you guys practice?
We practice every day when there's not a game for 2 hours. And we'll have 15 minutes on Tuesday, Thursday, football, so we put a lot of work in.
Thank you for being here with us.
Thank you.
The Benedictine University football team is off to a great start this year. The team already has 2 wins under their belt with a record of 2-1. Last week, Ryan Sample was selected as NACC Player of the Week. Jesse Kilborn led the team versus Adrian College last week with 7 receptions and ran for 107 yards. The Eagles defeated Adrian 35-28. I have the Eagles' Molly Morley talked with Kilborn.
Hi everyone, my name is Molly Morley and I'm here live at the Benedictine football game. Today I'm here with Jesse Kilborn. Jesse, congratulations on your win today. How does that one feel?
It feels great, Molly. It was a real big team win today, offensively, defensively. We had to win that game. We needed all phases of the game to go well, and at the end of the game, we just put it all together and found a way to win.
Well, congratulations. Last year, you led the team with 38 receptions and 2 touchdowns. What do you plan on accomplishing this year?
You know, it's not really an individual accolade I want to accomplish. It's more of a team. I would love for us to go as far as we've ever gone before. And that goes, and everyone around me is the reason why I get such good stats. The offensive line, giving Sample plenty of time to throw the ball, the receivers making great plays to open it up for me. Our run game, our running backs are great. They run hard every time. So it's not just me, it's a whole team collectively. And I thank them for a great job that they do.
How do you think you and your team will prepare for Rockford in 2 weeks?
We're going to take a week off. We got a bye week coming up. We're going to get some guys back that got hurt today. And we're going to get them healthy. But, we've played Rockford. They're in our conference, and they're a consistent team. We're just going to look at the tape, and we're going to go from there. It should be a great game, though.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for letting me interview you today.
Thank you, Molly.
Bye.
The men's soccer team came out ready to play Wednesday night against their rival, Aurora University. The Eagles soared to victory over AU for the first time since 2008. Benedictine was able to score 6 goals, while Aurora was left scoreless. With this victory, the Eagles are now 6-3-1 on the season. Pedro Pera, who recorded an assist in the game, spoke with Eye of the Eagles' Michelle Riley about his team's big upset.
Hi, I'm Michelle Riley, and I'm here with Pedro Paja after the men's soccer game versus Aurora. So, Pedro, the game obviously went very well. You guys came out on top 6-0. So, what do you guys think about the
I think the first 20 minutes of the game was determinant for the result because we got the chance to put 3 goals in their net. So, after that, we calmed down and was everything easy.
Awesome. And then, so, when we were playing against Aurora, so what was the mentality like going into the game?
The mentality before the game was they are a very good team, and since 2008 we don't get a win against Aurora, so it had to be this year, and then we came with everything that we had to get the victory this year.
So you guys haven't beat Aurora since 2008?
Yeah, since 2008, wow. Only loss and loss.
Wow. So the mentality then going in against Aurora was probably a lot different considering you guys have won 8 years versus every regular game. Was there a lot of energy going into the game?
Yes, the locker room, the music was very loud, the guys passing their energy to each other. The mentality was different because Aurora is a rival against here in Naples, in Lyle, against Benedictine. We are a big rival, and they have a very good team, so it was a very important victory for the conference tournament.
Awesome. All right, well, I want to say thank you to Pedro for being here with me, and this is Michelle Riley here with Iron Eagle Sports.
Women's soccer team kicked off family weekend on Saturday, September 17th, with the game against Elmhurst College. Unfortunately, the Eagles fell short and took the loss at home against Elmhurst with the final score of 1-0, making Benedictine's current season stats 5-4-2. Our Eye of the Eagles' Marissa Perez had the chance to speak to one of the starting players, Janae Haney, before the game. Haney had some words of inspiration and enthusiasm to share with our viewers. Let's take a look at what she had to say.
Hi, thank you for joining us here at Eye of the Eagle. I'm the soccer player here at Benedictine University. Hi,
we're in live today, Haney. I'm playing with you at Benedictine. This is my 3rd year playing on the soccer team. Today we're playing Elmhurst. Today we're playing a really big game. I'm excited. I was always working hard, dedicated, hard work, and never giving up.
The Benedictine men's golf team competed in a home event at Seven Bridges Golf Course. The team continued to impress as they played competitive golf, having two golfers in the top 20. Donnie Rollins finished 8th, collecting a piece of hardware. Brad Riva also finished in the top 20 for the Eagles. All right, sports fans, that's all we have for October. Tune in November, where we will be discussing men's and women's basketball.
What are you going to be for Halloween?
I plan on being Kronk from The Emperor's New Groove.
What is your favorite Halloween movie?
Halloween Town.
What is your favorite Halloween movie?
My favorite Halloween movie would have to be Hocus Pocus.
What do you plan on dressing up as for Halloween?
Either Princess Jasmine, maybe a tourist or a banana, one of those.
What are you going to be for Halloween this year?
Harley Quinn.
Who's that?
From Suicide Squad.
Oh, awesome! What is your favorite Halloween movie?
Definitely my favorite Halloween movie would be Beetlejuice, because it's a little scary and it's funny, so it's a good combo.
Where are you going to be for Halloween this year?
I'm going to go as Mary Poppins.
What's your favorite Halloween movie?
Halloween with Michael Myers.
What do you plan on being for Halloween if you're planning on dressing up?
Maybe Minnie Mouse or Tinkerbell.
What is your favorite Halloween or scary movie?
The Grudge is really the only scary movie that's probably ever scared me in my life.
What are you dressing up for Halloween?
So I'll be dressing up as a 1920s gentleman with a suit, tie, everything, and a top hat.
Welcome back to In the Spotlight with Adam Sanchez.
Welcome back to In the Spotlight. I am your host, Adam Sanchez, and we are back with our guest, Jenny Brechtel. Before the break, we talked about our internship with the Kane County Cougars. Can you talk a little about the importance of internships for students and how it helped you individually?
Yeah, I think internships are really, really important, because if I hadn't done the different amount of internships that I had done, I don't think I would have gotten as many opportunities. Having an internship with Ive the Eagle and writing for the Candor and doing an internship with, webcasting the basketball games, that gave me the opportunity to be able to become a professor here, adjunct professor here, teaching classes that I wouldn't have been able to do if I laid low and didn't take all those different opportunities. And then I was working at the Cougars, and they actually asked me if I wanted a full-time job. So you have to be able to talk to a bunch of people and network and make sure that you make yourself known and make yourself visible more than laying low, because the amount of opportunities that you could get, you would never expect unless you, kept going and did multiple internships.
Yeah. So you said the Cougars offered you a full-time job. What was your job title there, and what were some of your duties and responsibilities?
Right when I began, I started in the ticket office.
Okay.
I worked for them for 5 seasons, and I had 4 different jobs when I was there. So I started in the ticket office just doing the, face-to-face right at the window. And then after that, I did group sales. So I would call a bunch of companies and ask if they would want to do a party at the ballpark. And then after I did that, I ended up becoming the promotions director. So that was in charge of every single thing that happens in between all the innings was my responsibility. And I was in charge of managing 8 to 10 promotional interns and staff members and stuff like that. So going from one extreme to another, just because I had started an internship there, I think it was one of the best experiences I could have ever had.
How would you say working with the Cougars helped you?
Like I said earlier, you wear a lot of hats when you're working at a minor league sporting, venue. It helped me to learn how to deal with people in regards to customer service. And then when I was dealing with the promotion stuff, it helped me learn how to plan things out. It helped me to write press releases. And all of that stuff is important, no matter where you go for a job. So I think it helped me to find 5 or 6 different things that I could do well. And that way I was able to move on, with my life, with knowing that I can do a couple different things well because I had done so many different things in one spot.
Okay, great. You are now the marketing coordinator at Intact. What are some of your job responsibilities? responsibilities there?
I write press releases there. I do a company newsletter. I also help with the website content, and we submit proposals. So a lot of the proposals, I help with, you know, reading the proposals and finding grammatical errors and things like that. Right now we're working on the Christmas card, fun stuff like that, and I also get to help, you know, place the order for holiday baskets for all of our clients and things like that. So no matter where you go, you're going to have a lot of different things to do.
Okay, one thing, what's the number one thing you miss about working with the Cougars?
The one thing I miss most about working with the Cougars is probably the people. When you work somewhere 80 hours a week, they become your family.
Okay.
So that's something that I miss.
Okay, thank you. That's all the time we have for today. I'm your host, Adam Sanchez, and you have watched In the Spotlight.